Welcome back, everybody. What is up? My name is Charlie Sardelli, and I'm here with
Jameson Amoros,
Oscar Ibarra.
And as always, we are living in Colorado, the Mile High Perspective. Welcome to another episode of Real Estate Served on the Rocks, guys. Remember, we drop our episodes weekly. Vocals on Friday, video anytime between Monday and Wednesday, and you can catch our YouTube channel anytime. We got community spotlight videos on there for you. We got new build home videos coming up on there. So guys, please let us know where you want us to go, what do you want to see, and what do you want us to talk about? Because at the end of the day, we're just three Colorado realtors here to bring you, the consumer, information while enjoying some fantastic bourbon.
And apparently we're talking about ourselves as vocalists.
Yes, we're vocalists.
We're like a boy band.
You know what?
Wow.
Since when?
I don't know.
I've been here for a while.
He said our vocals drop every Friday. So
oh shoot,
I didn't realize.
Watch out for the the album cover dropping.
Yeah. I'm zoned out right now. I was like, what?
NSYNC got shit on us.
Yeah, damn right. I mean, not with you two rocking some nice shoes like those.
Yeah.
You know twinsies. What? There's a story behind this, and
hey, it's dope.
The story is I wanted to be 2 inches taller.
No, yeah. I like it. Play to live.
I like off the wall shoes. Most of my shoes are like colorful, and I saw these. Our buddy Shelby's like, dude, these are dropping golf shoes, blah, blah, blah. So we were waiting on him, bought them, and he hasn't bought them, and they're sold out.
And I blame him now because now I've signed up for all of the new drops.
Yep.
Nice.
And they're like, they're
and I'm not a sneakerhead.
I'm not. Apparently, you can resell these for what, $500 right now?
$500 to $600.
I'm going to start OnlyFans.
Hey.
Of just feet pics, but feet pics with Air Max golf shoes.
I was going to say, but I mean, that's what we're here to talk about today.
Investments. Right?
Investments. Yes. Money minds.
Passive income.
Passive income.
Speaking of boy bands, I watched, I'm a fan, and I watched the roast of the Jonas Brothers.
Oh, okay.
You know what? It was a cheesy roast, but those guys are cool.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
If you listen to the lyrics, the lyrics are, they're different. I think they're just like teeny bopper.
Yeah.
The lyrics are like, man, get out of here. Because you're going to love me, and, you know, this is how I talk when I get naked. It's like, what?
It just reminds me of the South Park episode where it's Mickey Mouse, and he's with the promise rings. He's like, just go out there and shake your butts. Yeah. Make the girls love you. Well, guys, like we said, today's topic that we're going to cover is passive income in real estate and how it relates to real estate. And, of course, while we're talking about it, we've got a fine bourbon here. I'm drawing a blank on the name. I know it has
Ironclad,
a ship Ironclad background, right? Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, we got some Civil War history in this one.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
So it's distilled in Newport News, Virginia. So if you guys don't know where that's at, I suggest Google Maps. It's pretty easy. But it's on the East Coast, a little north of Virginia Beach. I actually lived there for, almost 10 years, I want to say. Oceana Naval Air Base is over there. But anyway, they distill this right across from the Newport News Naval Shipyard. And their whole kind of shtick is they call it like a bourbon whiskey without compromise. It's family owned. It's been family owned since its inception. It's a 50%, so 100 proof, which we've been on a streak of higher proof bourbons. And their rickhouse is right next to the James River. If you guys have ever been to Virginia Beach or Virginia in general, you take the James River up, you can hit Williamsburg, a bunch of historical sites. But the James River is what's called a brackish river, which means it mixes fresh water and salt water. And that air, as it evaporates, goes into this rickhouse since it's brackish.
Brackish?
Yep. Not like the show Blackish. Brackish.
Never heard that term.
For soccer fans, not Grealish. Brackish. But basically, it's when it's salt water and fresh water mix, normally in like the mouth of a bay that opens out in the ocean. And that brackish seawater then infiltrates the barrels, which they age for a minimum of 2 years, and give it a unique flavor. So,
I mean, just from the bourbons that we've been having, I mean, you can tell how true they are to the process because of how dark it is.
Mm-hmm.
Especially, you know, it seems that a lot of the bourbons that we've tried that tend to say we are tried and true, we're real bourbon, we don't do anything, you know, different with our distilling process, they tend to be a little bit darker. And I mean, I mentioned it last week, but yeah, even in here, you can see some particulates in the bourbon. Not bad, but you can definitely see some grain in the bourbon compared to like what we had last week. It was very clear.
What'd you have last week?
The
Dexter.
The world's greatest bourbon that we've ever had.
Dexter 3-Wood. It was actually really good.
Bro, you were here last week.
You were just in a barrel.
You were in the barrel last week.
Remember? I was in the barrel.
Yeah, you were in the barrel because we moved the couch and we put the barrel there instead.
I was
it's like
out.
It goes along with Oscar the Grouch in the trash can. You're in a barrel.
Well, And so well, Jameson, tell us.
There's a character in Mexican television called El Chavo del Ocho.
Okay.
That dude lives in a barrel.
There you go.
Perfect.
See, that's who you are. I like it. Beautiful. You got to change your whole spiel now.
All right. So give us the background.
It's a cool history, right?
Yeah.
So the Battle of the Ironclads is one of the most famous military naval battles in history because it was the first time that there were two literally ironclad ships, which led to us now having naval destroyers and whatnot.
Okay.
Before this, they were wood, right? And it was the USS Monitor and the CSS Virginia were the two ships. They fought to a draw because, again, two ironclad ships using technology that was probably built for firing on wood ships.
Mm-hmm.
And it was off of, I believe it was, yeah, off of Hampton Roads. So right in that same Newport News area, Virginia Beach, Hampton Roads, Norfolk, if you guys are familiar with it.
You said a lot in that breath.
Oh, yeah, you did.
Yeah.
After he was done, I was like,
yeah. I mean, they're kind of cool. So it's basically, they were like giant Frisbees.
Huh.
So the surface that you see on the water, yeah, aside from the little turret in the top, 18 inches of steel is all that protruded from the water.
Interesting.
Because they were so heavy.
I mean, ships in general. I was in Naval ROTC in high school, and like, I remember the first time I went and saw the USS South Carolina, or USS Carolina in South Carolina, and I remember I walked up to it, I was like, it's an aircraft carrier. How the hell does this thing float? Like, what are you talking about? This is just tons and tons of metal just floating on the water. So it's cool that this is where it came from.
I want like a funny cartoon graphic because they describe this battle, right? Like, yeah. I said, they're using cannonballs that were built to sink wooden ships. So these two ships were just circling each other for 4 hours, just firing off cannonballs.
Hammering each other.
And every single cannonball just kept bouncing off the ship until they both gave up and went back to the port. Neither of them sustained damage.
Yep.
And they just fought to a draw.
The You're moment like, that need, warfare changed.
We need to have your weaponry. This isn't working.
So it's kind of wild. Just
that's
like,
awesome.
I imagine being like back in the 1860s and just watching these two ships just ping pong off of each other for 4 hours.
All you're hearing from miles out is like ping, ping, ping. Yep. Well, Jameson, I mean,
sure earlier, it wasn't a pink, man.
It was like,
boom,
yeah. Boom.
Yeah.
Oh,
well, Jameson, funny. I mean, earlier you were playing around with the bottle and you said that there was a surprise or something in there.
I don't know.
Well, and while we're talking about the particulates, right?
Yeah.
Tried and true. They don't mess with it. There is a few distilleries that I've tried. They're usually newer age distilleries that want to hurry up the process. Mm-hmm. It costs money to make this.
Yeah.
And then you got to wait.
Mm-hmm.
The episode today, investments, right? They wait years, three, on the low end, to make a good bourbon. Well, they speed up the process by flavoring them. And you'll see the bottles, and there's a lot of particulates in it.
Yep.
There's a lot of flavors. They try to match what aging will do, but it doesn't. Oh, good.
Oh.
I'm glad it wasn't what I said it was going to be earlier.
Oh.
All right, so show them. What are we looking at?
I don't know if this is like, you know, when you rub like a lamp and a genie comes out? I mean, I peeled this, and it says men wanted for the Navy, so I don't know if I am now being recruited.
Oh, no. Now you have to go
right?
enlist.
Is that, now I have to enlist?
What's on the backside of it?
There's hold on. So all able-bodied men not in the employment of the Army will be enlisted into the Navy upon application at the Naval Rendezvous on Craven Street, next door to the printing office.
Oh, so they pulled
from
like
1863. So this was the
that must have been like a news cover.
This is
like
a news cover,
recruiting cover. That's all. Yeah, show it to the
so apparently if you didn't cut it in the Navy or the Army, you just went to the Navy. Which I don't know who.
And
doesn't
then
cut
I see there's
Army.
Something on the back of it.
I know. We're gonna find that
we got
out too.
Layers,
give me
baby.
A second, baby. There's layers to this shit. I think Drake said that once.
Navy the
future
seals.
Two chains, one of them. This is that's funny. This is what I just looked up on the internet.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
This gives you the story.
Hours of close range action. Neither had sunk. Their story went down in history.
Yep. Very cool.
Cool.
Very, very cool.
I like it.
Yeah.
It's like a little treasure hunt.
Yeah. It's, I mean, it's, again, you know, we always talk about shticks that companies do, but.
Yeah. No, this is cool. I like it.
Yeah.
This is, to me, it's a shtick, but it's like.
It works.
Good.
Yeah. It's
well,
memorable.
It works.
And
it's memorable. I like the black on black.
I do like the black
on black.
I like the black on black.
That bottle we so wanted to love. The 10 horsemen.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
The story was awesome. Stood for was awesome, but the juice inside was just not. It was subpar. I'm sorry.
Absolutely.
Let's
go ahead and get these first sips here.
Here's two ships. Some ships are wooden ships, but those ships, they sink. The best ships are friendships, and to those ships we drink.
Cheers. Might be the most timely toast in
that was good.
Podcast history.
Yeah,
right there.
That was good.
I like it.
Hmm. I mean, on the nose.
On the nose, I get chocolate.
Sweeter, yeah. A lot,
especially now that it's kind of, it's not the neck pour.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot sweeter.
Oh, I see a significant difference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a 100%. It's a different bourbon.
I still get, on the beginning end, a little sweeter, but now that I've pinpointed where I was tasting, yeah. I get cucumber. Not in a bad way.
Yeah.
I get like a cucumber, you know, when you just
yeah
fresh cucumbers, that's what I'm getting, in a good mm-hmm. way.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean,
a little bit of burn, but
just a little bit.
For 100 proof.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, honestly, yeah, to your point, it comes strong at the beginning with that more of that earthy kind of spice flavor.
Mm-hmm.
And then towards the end, I definitely get that sweetness. And for me, it's tailoring more at the back end towards that vanilla.
Yeah.
And that caramel. But I mean, just how it sits on the tongue, it's sweet. Like yeah, that's
the lingering flavor I would say caramel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And yep. I mean, like I said, the nose it's not very punchy. Okay.
No, the nose, start. I think you nailed the nose. It's kind of like a chocolate orange mm-hmm. kind of.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of zesty, but chocolatey. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I like it.
It's
I like
refreshing.
It.
Refreshing.
All right.
This, okay. These guys, I guess, have a membership that you can be a part of where they do craft cocktails
uh-huh.
and they put them in bottles.
Okay.
And then they keep them at their tasting room.
But do they use artificial intelligence to tailor
They actually do not.
So that was something cool last week, Oscar. The Dexter,
oh, yeah.
They use, you can go to their distillery, and using AI and what you put in for your taste, you can watch as they mix
different barrels
for you and create your own special blend.
Nice.
Yeah. Pretty cool.
But this one is, they just, you pay the membership, and then you go in, each one pours 8 cocktails.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you don't finish it, obviously.
Nice. Which,
that'd be a long day.
That'd be a real long day.
Then you can take it home. $75 a month.
Not bad.
No.
Not bad.
Not bad at
especially
all.
Not if you're an enthusiast and want to try it.
Well, you figure that's what? At 8 cocktails.
Mm-hmm.
That's not bad.
No. Especially, I mean, with a good quality bourbon. Yeah. I went out with some friends last week and I've spent $17 on a scotch bacon kind of bourbon and took a first sip of it. I was like, yep, should not have paid $18 for this thing. But on that note, of things being what they should be or what they're not, what we want to talk about today, like I said, is passive income and passive income in relation to real estate. So kind of the way that we want to talk about this, the flow that we're going to go with on today's episode is we want to talk about, first off, what is passive income? What is the idea behind it? What is the purpose of it?
And more importantly, what is it not?
Yes. What is it not? Exactly. And then we're going to kind of move into the idea of using real estate for passive income. So we want to talk about lending and how it looks for investment, secondary properties, and then kind of move from there into like earning,
yeah.
right? What is the value of this? And what would it really take to achieve this vision of passive income on real estate?
Well, yeah, because you got these damn TikTokers
yeah.
mm-hmm. that are just going in saying buy properties and investing in real estate yeah. is how people get wealthy, which is true.
Yes.
But the beauty of watching a 30-second video is you get the highlights, right, Oscar? yeah.
mm-hmm.
Hey, Oscar, I want to use you. I'm going to go buy an investment property. Should only take me about 2 hours. And people are getting this, you know, idea with the side hustle, everything mm-hmm. out of the pandemic.
Gig economy.
And we just want to make sure, like, number one, I speak on behalf of these gentlemen. I believe real estate is one of the best, if not the best, pathways
mm-hmm.
to generational wealth that you can
absolutely.
You can have, right? Hands down, no argument from me whatsoever. But I also want to make sure that, and we want to make sure that you guys have realistic expectations as
yes.
far as what that actually looks like. Because when people hear, I'm just going to invest in real estate. Mm-hmm. Like there's a bunch of different ways that you can do it.
Yep.
The one of those popular right now is like house flipping or buying Airbnb. A house and renting it out.
House Airbnb. Flipping is instant money. Right.
right?
Yeah. And then there's long-term rentals. And
yep.
you know, when you said generational income, they're not making any more land. You got to talk mm-hmm. to the man upstairs if you want that. And once it's yours, right? But what people don't understand is that when you go into real estate, it's more of a long-term game unless you're flipping mm-hmm. and it's less volatile. Yes, we're the front runners when it comes to economies.
Mm-hmm.
The real estate industry gets hit first, but that's on the earned income side,
right? Yeah.
Right? So try playing the stock market. You'll lose thousands, if not mm-hmm. millions, fast, mm-hmm. overnight.
Well,
in real estate, you won't lose them and it's there.
Yeah.
It's something tangible that you could go visit.
Yep.
It's yours.
A physical asset.
Well, yes. And it's you know, we talked about, touched on this, I think, 2 episodes when the last one you were on, Oscar, where you know, you just, you got to zoom out, right? And mm-hmm. you can have dips. And like you said, the housing market's always going to be the first one to take the hit.
Yep.
We're also going to be the first ones to recover.
Mm-hmm. And our hits aren't that hard.
Right. So, but the reason that we want to talk about it is because there's this idea of investing in real estate from a being able to rent out so on and so forth, this passive income.
Yep.
So Oscar, give me your definition of passive income.
So earned income, you go clock in, you make your money, right? You work for your money. Passive income is your money works for you. Whether you wake up in the morning or not, your money's earning you money.
Right?
So it's that's just passive income.
Compounding, it's yep. you don't have to do anything.
Don't mm-hmm. have to do anything for passive
you
income.
You don't work for it.
So if I say
it works
that,
for you.
If I say that I want to buy a property and rent it out for passive income, would you correct me that it's not passive?
Yes and no. There's equations that you have to take into place, you know, return on investment. What you're going to invest in when it's you're going to be in the out of the red, you know, you're going to mm-hmm. Typically when you buy an investment property and for not paying all cash, you need at least 20% down. So what does that look like? Mm-hmm. What's the return on your money? You mm-hmm. use round numbers. Well, if you're buying a $100,000 property, put 20% yeah. down. You know, after what point are you making money off your 20%? On top of that, if you put $20,000 in a bank and you put it on a decent vehicle, mm-hmm. right, that's low risk.
Like a CD.
You're going to earn, what, 8%, mm-hmm. yeah. roughly? Let's mm-hmm. use that. So that's annually. With this, if you're making off the bat $200 to $300 monthly, I think that's a better return on your investment. And that's Fair. how I approach investors yeah. when I want to invest in my own stuff. When I was doing fix and flips, I would give them a return on their money monthly.
Yeah.
Because they're gaining interest annually mm-hmm. and very low yep. unless they're in a high risk vehicle,
right?
Like something tied into the market that will gain you 15%, but you can also lose your ass off, right. if not all.
Well, and that's a good point that you brought up too, Oscar, is that a lot of people, you know, they go, I'm going to buy this property and then I'm going to put money into it. I'm going to flip it. I'm going to rent it out and I'm going to sell it. Now, what people don't realize is if you go the rental route, you are now the landlord. You are now the owner of that property. And if you are renting it, you are legally obligated to keep it up to livable code. And what that takes is money and time. So a lot of the time when it comes to real estate and passive income, the idea of passive income being, I'm sitting on this couch and I am not doing anything, but I'm making money. Real estate is not that avenue No. when it comes to passive income, unless you are looking at something like fix and flip, where it's a large investment, dump it, get rid of it. But a lot of people these days don't have
Yeah, but
the
even
capital.
Still, that wouldn't be passive, because if I'm actually doing the fix and flip,
yeah,
if I'm not the contractor,
yeah.
then I'm hiring somebody. If I'm the investor that's financing the fix and flip,
yes.
then maybe, but you're not guaranteed a return.
Exactly.
Right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I think it's a misnomer at very least mm-hmm. that being a renter, you know, or a landlord is a passive income.
Well, and let me go ahead and give you, I'm going to be the stat guy on this
Ooh.
One. So let me go ahead and give you
throw my notebook away.
An idea of passive income in America. So the last census in America stated that 20% of Americans have quote unquote passive income. So let me ask you guys, if I were to ask you, what do you think those Americans are earning a year within passive income?
A year, mm-hmm. Average, $2,000 to $3,000.
Okay. Jameson?
Yeah, I'd probably go around like, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably around right? the same.
But if you now, and beautiful, beautiful guesses, gentlemen, but again, you have your fingers on the pulse of investment and money, it's $4,000 a year. Okay. So to the idea that we see on social media of passive income, what I ask you is, can you live off of $4,000 a year, right? Are you going to sit back and go, I'm good, I'm making $4,000 a year? So like, that's why I wanted to shoot that number out and throw yeah. that number out, because when you hear 20% of Americans have passive income, if your idea of passive income is TikTok, social media, passive income, you're going, oh damn, it's doable. Everybody, wow, that's a good amount of people.
And what's the initial investment on those $4,000?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's right. What I like to know.
Well, and then again, don't forget too, that's stay at home moms that are making resin cups. You know, that's...
And again, it's not passive.
Yeah, because they're putting in the work.
That's earned income.
Right,
right.
Exactly.
That's,
that's a side hustle. Mm-hmm. That's very, yeah, very yeah. different.
Yep.
That's yeah. If I take $20,000 and park it into the S&P 500, and all I do is invest $100 a week mm-hmm. for the rest of my life, that's passive income.
Yep.
Because that's compounding
and
interest.
And then let's touch the subject of renting being passive income. Structured well, it can be.
Yes.
Yep.
You know, it's upkeep. Mm-hmm. So when you structure something out for a rental... you're not just going to say, all right, I'm going to drop $20,000. Let's let it ride. You drop $20,000 acquisition. And then you have costs, maintenance costs, right? So say that your roof is brand new. You're going to need to replace it, hopefully within 10 to 15 years. Let's get on that. What's that going to cost you, whether it's a deductible or if it's going to be out of pocket? Then you take that number divided by those years, then divided by a monthly, tack that on your monthly rent.
Yep.
And then you tack on water heater, you tack on all these maintenance costs, right?
Yeah.
And then miscellaneous, right? Yeah. So you have your payment and all the miscellaneous costs. Mm-hmm. That's your working, what your working ledger is, right?
Yeah, I think anything
after that is the passive income.
Right.
Yep.
But then you don't get caught with your pants down.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're smart, you'll hire an asset management company. So then you literally, acquisition, let it ride.
Yep. But at that point, you're also, your return is less.
Yes.
Which means you have to do this more often, right?
And that's,
I think that's
the return is less, but you don't have to do anything with
I'm saying like you go from, let's say I'm planning on making, like, because a lot of people say, okay, I want to invest in real estate to the point where it's going to replace my salary.
Yes.
Okay. So let's say your salary in Colorado right now, on average, call it $65,000 a year, right? You got to get to a point where if I have to, Oscar, what you just said, right? Let's say I do have a property management company that's charging me 10 to 15% a month gross rent. I've got 5% a month put away for cap expenses. I've got 10% a year put away for, 5% for upkeep, 10% a year for cap expenses like roof, water heater, AC, major appliances, that kind of thing. If I go from making $900 a month in cash flow, right, then I need X amount of properties to break that $65,000.
Well, and yeah, and that's what I was
gonna say. But if I make
it
more and more automated, and I'm less and less hands off, so I'm more and more passive, I still now have to do the work to find more properties.
Yes.
Because I have to make up the difference. If I go from making 900 cash flow to 350 cash flow, I got to buy twice as many properties, I have to put in the work to find those.
And
properties.
That's the long game, right? Because in the beginning, you're going to make minimal margins, but then what's going to happen? Appreciation. And you're going to buy that loan down.
Yep.
If you put 20% down. So it's going to gain double. With appreciation annually if we're in a decent market, and the loan's going to go down. So in 5 to 7, maybe 10 years, when you're like, all right, I'm feeling like I don't want to work anymore, you refinance that, leverage your money. If you need to pull some out, whatever. At that point, you have more equity. But then it drops your payment substantially. At that point is where now you're making the 900 to 1,000 per property. Say you got 10 of them, now you got 10 grand a month, whether you wake up or not.
Yep. Okay. But so again, you have to go through
all
of the calculations. You have to put a net sheet together. You got to find a lender. You got to apply for a HELOC or a cash out refi.
You better have
Go find properties. You then have to apply for another loan via that next property. You have to turn around and then go renovate that home. Does any of that sound passive?
Okay. So, right?
Well, no. So the initial is work.
Right, that's
but
what I'm saying.
Then afterwards, it's passive.
Right.
You just need to know the structure. Once you do it the first time, the next 10 times is easy.
Well,
it's easier.
And that's what I was going to say. So let's go ahead and let's create the scenario, okay? So you got Bobby Joe and Susie Joe together coming up to you.
Wait,
and
from the South?
Yes. Yes, I am, Oscar.
They're a married couple and also cousins.
Right. But they come up and they want to start investing, right?
Yep.
They want to go passive income real estate property. So let's talk about the lending process and how you can fund that and what that usually takes. Oscar, you touched on it earlier. A lot of the time, you know, with your primary residence, you can go FHA, you can do 5% down, but a lot of the time for investment properties, lenders have a couple more stringent things that they need you to do. Let's go ahead and dive into that. How does the money acquisition portion, what does that look like in order to buy an investment or secondary property to rent?
If you have decent income, decent credit, 20% down conventional, you could do it all day.
Okay.
If you need a little bit more creative, there's companies like Merchants Mortgage that they will, acquisition is going to be a little more expensive. This is more for fix and flips. They'll lend you acquisition and remodel cost. And they're very, I want to say, lenient when it comes to guidelines. As long as you have great credit, they'll work with you.
Okay. So let's go ahead and
but they will charge you. They charge you a little bit more. I think it's a point and a half.
Yeah.
So whatever the purchase amount, if they charge you a point and a half, and then there's a couple of other closing costs. But it's typically 80% loan to value.
Okay.
Yeah. And there's the first question that you got to ask, right, is what the goal is.
Yes.
Because your goal is either, hey, I want the money quick, right? So in that case, fix and flip. for the most part, if you're doing fix and flips, hard money loans, loans that will include, like Oscar said, the renovation loan, right? Mm-hmm. Construction loan, whatever that looks like. And those are usually shorter term.
Yep.
And the goal is to fix it, to flip it, to rent it, and then take out the equity and then do it again.
Right? Well, so even with a fix and hold, right?
Rental. Yeah.
Say that you're going to do a fix and hold. I would still go with merchant's mortgage because they're not that expensive, mm-hmm. but they will fund a whole lot more.
Right.
So leverage your money, right? That's what I preach. Mm-hmm. If you got 20% down and they're gonna give you a certain amount for a remodel cost, so you go in and they do, I think, 15-month terms. But you're going to be paying a monthly. So if you're going to be in and out quick, get the acquisition and the remodel with them, fix it up, do what you need to do as quickly as possible, mm-hmm. hire great crews. It's just structuring at this point. So mm-hmm. it's not hard work for you unless you're a contractor, then you're going to do a lot of the work and save the money yourself, but get it fixed up to par. Then at that point, you refinance out of their loan. Mm-hmm. One, it's going to be better. Mm-hmm. You already have a loan on it. Mm-hmm. So when you refinance into a traditional bank, there might be a lot more equity in that property.
Right. So now let's go with kind of, we're going to use average numbers, guys, because obviously trying to compare this across the United States is difficult with how the market is and the differences in the market. So average home price right now in the United States is, we'll say
450. 450.
450, right? So on a 20% down payment for the average price home in America, you're looking at 90 grand.
$90,000, yep.
Right? $90,000, and that's to get in.
Right.
Right? So that's something that I really want to kind of harp on. Is we often talk about how when you're doing personal residences, your own personal home, you don't need 20% down anymore. Mm-hmm. But like Oscar was saying, a lot of the time, if you don't have spot clean credit, really good credit, you will have to come up with that amount of money. And $450,000, especially you want to compare it to Colorado, where the average home price last month was
582.
Yeah, like that. 580. Yeah. Now we're talking about 100 grand just to get into your first. That's just the down payment. That doesn't include, like Oscar was saying, the cost of renovations, the contractors, right? So now you're already $90,000 to $100,000 in the hole. So Oscar, you have a lot of experience with fix and flips. If you could give me an average cost that somebody would have to prepare for to fix up a property after that down payment, what would you say?
Rental or
flip? Let's stick with rental.
Rental?
Mm-hmm.
I think... easy side, you're at least going to be 15K.
Okay. So
get
that's
a part.
So what
on the heavy
saying,
side, maybe 30. Yeah,
you're talking two, if it's a two bed, two bath, you're talking flooring replaced and the bathrooms.
But what I want to point out,
flooring, paint, appliances, anything that's going to be,
well,
not up to par with standards, and right. Denver's passed some pretty stringent ones now.
And that was my whole point, right? Is the reason that I
or you might just get
that,
a good one. I mean, right? It could only be like $5,000.
But that's what I was saying is, to your point, the reason I wanted to come up with that cost, right, is a lot of the sentiment that you have from renters is the landlord fixing, right, mm-hmm. where they go in and they'll just paint over,
lipstick.
Like an outlet.
It's lipstick.
Yeah,
right?
Lipstick, right? So even at the lowest end, like you said, if you get a good place, you're looking
five grand.
But if you get something and then you even do the landlord special on it, you're probably still spending around $10,000 to bring it up to at least code in order to be able to rent it, right? So now down payment plus initial investment, and we'll go on the low end for you, we're already over $110,000, right? Or right around $110,000. Mm-hmm. So looking at how the economy is right now, that's not very easy for a lot of people. So, and again, guys, by no means are we trying to position this as it's unavailable, people can't do it, but we want to bring it into the light and make it real for you, because at the end of the day, I can watch 20 TikToks, reels, mm-hmm. whatever it is, of these 18-year-olds saying, well, I just got my first rental property. Okay, where'd you get the money
from? I did
from?
A TikTok on it. Do you guys
yeah.
remember?
Yeah.
I tied it into the billions guy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, again, that was my biggest thing. I was like, they go to a get-rich-quick real estate seminar, and they're
yep.
like, I'm going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And you can. There's ways to leverage. There's grants you could dig into.
Yes.
There is ways. Easiest way, homeownership.
Mm-hmm.
I could show you how to set it up long term.
Mm-hmm.
Get you your first house, you're in, get you the equity, home line of credit, all that crap. Yes, we could do it. But they think it's so easy, like, oh, I'm going to have $1,000 I could get in my property. Yes, you can.
If
it's the only property you own.
Well, right? And now let's go. So we did down payment. We did renovation costs. Now let's talk about, again, we're talking about passive income where you're sitting on the couch not having to do anything, right? Now let's talk about if you want that to be the way it is, a management company for that property.
And you could do it yourself. You really can.
But again,
do you really want to
pull credit?
Exactly.
Background checks, meet with everyone that's going to be there, and then take the phone calls for maintenance calls. Collect rents every month. Make sure there's a lot that's which people like that.
Well, yeah, but
which
to your,
is fine.
But
you'll
to the whole
some money.
Point of passive income, what you just said, you're collecting rent every month, so you have to be mentally aware of when that rent comes in. So, on the idea and continuing with passive income, let's go with you hire a management company. On average, Oscar, what is your experience with costs on management companies?
A couple hundred bucks
a month. So
it's about seven to 10%.
7 to 10.
Right.
Okay.
For long term.
Yep.
You go Airbnb short term, you're up to 25-30%.
All right, and you go Airbnb short term, and then you got cleaning costs. So right. That adds more to it.
Yeah.
So you get more money.
You do. And I think the point that Charlie's trying to make is like there's a lot that goes into owning investment properties, whether it's short term, whether it's long term. The purpose is like if you guys are looking to go that route, and not a self plug, but this is why it's important to work with people that understand what's happening.
We look at
something like cash on cash return, right?
Yep.
And you hear that another buzzword on TikTok, like, oh, this cash on cash, this deal's a 22% cash on cash return. Mm-hmm. Okay, so no, you're not going to find that, right? But here's the easy way, just so you guys understand how to calculate.
I mean, you go to Oklahoma, Kansas, all those other states.
You may
be able to do it, not here in Colorado.
Right.
No.
Right.
But when we talk cash on cash return, we're
essentially saying is, what is your return percentage on the amount that you've initially invested, right? Mm-hmm. So the easy way to figure that out is you take what your rent is, right? What you're charging. So let's say you're charging, and I mean, this is why in Colorado it's hard to find. Let's say you're charging $3,000 a month in rent.
Yep.
Okay. And then all of your monthly expenses that Oscar just detailed, along with your mortgage payment, you're cash flowing $230 a month, right? After everything, you pay a property management company, you make it as hands-off as humanly possible. It's $230, right? And let's just take your idea of the... Hold on, guys.
Pulling up the calculator.
Yeah,
for those on audio.
Yeah, your idea of an average, let's say a townhome is $450, $450,000, right? So you got to put, if it's an investment property, you're renting it out, you got to put 20% down minimum. So that's $90K.
Yep.
You've got probably $10,000 in closing costs because it's an investment property. You're going to be charged a higher interest rate at 3 or 4 points right now, just to get you to 7.8%. That 7.8% is going to make your mortgage payment higher. So again, let's say you're cash flowing $250 a month on a $450,000 property that you have put in, and we'll say you didn't even renovate it.
Yeah.
You just did down payment and closing costs. So you're in $100,000, right? Mm-hmm. So to figure out what your cash on cash return is, you take that gross monthly rent and multiply it by 12 for a year, right? So what did I say, 250?
Yep.
So 250 times 12, you're grossing $3,000. And then you divide that by the cash that you invested, which in this case would be $100,000. That cash on cash return is
3%.
Which is money in savings.
Yep.
Right? You can get a CD for 4.6%.
Right.
And it's much less work. So that's the whole point. And I think it's important because
only difference is on I like to play devil's advocate on both sides, is now you have an asset.
Correct.
And money.
And you got somebody paying the principal down, right?
And you're going to be gaining you're going to be gaining appreciation, hopefully 3-6%.
Yep.
So you tack that on top. And again, you have that asset.
Mm-hmm.
But that asset's going to be there.
That's the point, right? Because it depends on what your goal is.
So if even
your
goal minimally, if it's 3%,
yes,
you at least have an asset.
Yeah, if your goal is,
not
I
great,
just want to accumulate properties and have somebody else live there, I'm going to be hands off and I'm okay with $250 a month in income, if you want to even call it that.
Mm-hmm.
But the goal is, I want to buy a property a year so that in 10 years I have 10 properties and then I can do some refinancing and so on and so forth. And you know what? That's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Like that's a great way to do it, right? If that's not your goal, then some people try and get into this and go, wait a second, I'm only making $250. Okay, so let's say you're still trying to replace that $65,000 a year income.
Well, yeah, and that's where I wanted to get to is, again, the idea of passive income is the ability to sit and do nothing. And what Jameson just... did there on the cash on cash return, what he broke down for you is basically what it looks like for one single property. Mm-hmm. The effort, the money, the return on a single investment property that is average, an average of the nation, not certain markets. Because again, you try and do this in the Colorado market, you're significantly higher. And don't forget too, guys, there's factors that play into it, like taxes, right? We talked about it episodes ago.
Yeah.
Everybody in Colorado is talking about it. The Gallagher Amendment here, they're trying to find some way to give us a break on our taxes for homes, but that's single homes. They're not looking at giving breaks on secondary or rental properties. So now, not only is your average home price higher, but you have the potential to pay even more in taxes, which, again, now that $3,000 that you just made that year, take 10% out of that.
Right.
Right? If not more.
Because you look at it this way, right? So a $450,000 townhome. Mm-hmm. Let's say that's what I'm looking for. It's what? 3-bed, 2-bath, 1,500 square feet, somewhere around there, right? If you look at what you can rent that for the most part, you're probably looking at $3,400.
I would say let's do average.
On the high end,
say
right?
Yeah, let's do average of on that rental. So
it depends on where you're at,
obviously.
I was going
to say, let's go low.
If you're downtown, yeah.
Yeah, so let's go $3,000 a month. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. With 20% down, your mortgage payment by itself is $3,184.
Mm-hmm.
So you are already upside down. Yep. Without paying a management company, without pulling 5% for upkeep, without pulling 10% a year for capital expenses, without any of that, you're losing $184. Now, some people, again, are okay with being upside down because the goal is I want somebody else paying my mortgage. If I have to pay an extra $185 to secure a property and I have a second property that's going to be an asset, cool. But if you're looking for income, to go back to what we were just talking about, let's say you do make $250 a month.
Yep.
To replace $65,000 a year passively, you need 260 doors.
260 doors.
Well, and again, if you're trying to replace your income now, real estate's probably not the fastest way, unless you're doing flips.
Yes.
Then yes, I could show you how to do flips and make $30,000 to $40,000 in
3 months.
2 to 3 months.
Yep. Yeah, but again, on
60 to 90 days.
But on the note of passive income, there's
it's not passive.
No, it's not
passive.
You're doing all that work, right? Yep. And that's great. And I'll be honest with you. Like, the reason that I got into real estate was because I went, wait a second, the market's looking good. It's selling. I could benefit on this. I could make some money on it. But I am the perfect example. Use me as a scapegoat for it. I got into it, started looking at it. And I'll be honest with you guys. When I first started, I had significant capital to come in with.
Yep.
Right? But when you start looking at all of these things, you're going, I don't know if I want to dump all of my capital and my 6 month emergency funds into this possibility of maybe making $300 a month.
But you are the golden goose egg.
Yeah.
Because Charlie could come into this scenario with 3% down or even $1,000, buy the property, fix it, get premium interest, rent that bad boy out. Obviously, not going to tell your lender that.
Yep.
But then go buy you your house.
Oscar, that was perfect. Thank you. That is another point that I wanted to bring up too, is a lot of people think that you're going to buy this house, even if you don't have to do renovations to it, and then you can rent it. Guys, is that
doable? It's called mortgage fraud.
Yes, it's called mortgage fraud. But you better be buying another property.
Yep.
So, yes, if you buy a property and you're not going to live in it, it's mortgage fraud.
Yeah.
But is it doable? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Banks not.
But, they're not gonna go check it, on is you. It, you know, obviously, yes, it's doable, but at the
especially
same.
Especially if you use a grant.
Well, and that's what I was going to say, though, is it is doable, but at the same time, that is now in the name, in the realm of passive income. Even if you do that, you are now making sure and having to check that all your ducks are in a row when you're renting that so you don't get come after, right? And I know in Colorado, because again, like I said, I tried, I looked into it.
Mm-hmm.
You have to own for 2 years.
Correct.
Two to the last 5 years.
Yep.
And the thing is, if you do sell it and you're like, I'm going to make this money, well, capital gains you get it for 30%.
Yep.
So
again, and that's where, and again, guys, we're by no means are we trying to
discourage you.
Discourage you from doing it because
we're
it's
tell you
a phenomenal
how to do it the right way.
Exactly. If it's a phenomenal way to build wealth, generational wealth, everything. But at the same time, the whole reason we're doing this is because as people who are in this regularly and we know how it works, we see these people talking about it and getting people's hopes up and thinking that it's something that is a night and day difference. They make it easy.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, we've talked about a lot of just the inner workings of how investment properties work, right? Here's something else that you guys got to consider. If you are going to get a loan and you want it to be, let's say you want it long-term rental, mm-hmm. right? I'm going to rent it out, sign year leases, whatever. Well, there's two significant differences. You can buy a secondary property or a second home and put 10% down, mm-hmm. right? And you get, you know, I think right now I talked to one of our lender partners earlier. It's like 3.5 points to get to a 7.8, 7.9, right? So number one, very expensive. However, that secondary home has to be a minimum of 100 miles mm-hmm. away from your primary residence, mm-hmm. okay? And it has to be long-term. You can't do short-term, right? Yep. So let's say I want to do a secondary home because the points that I pay are better than if I were to do an investment property. And I'm going to short-term Airbnb out. Let's say I'm going to buy something on, I don't know, Lake of the Ozarks, right?
Mm-hmm. You know what's 100 miles from here?
Lake of the Ozarks.
Hugo.
Hugo. So I'm going to buy something in Hugo
because
their Airbnb is booming. But here's the deal. So let's say I need to use the rental income mm-hmm. to qualify to purchase it as a secondary home. Mm-hmm. If my plan is to use it as an Airbnb, well, if it's an Airbnb, they won't take it at all.
Yep.
If it's long-term, they'll take 75%. So mm-hmm. now I'm forced to go into investment, which now I got to put an extra 10%. Now I'm at 20% down minimum, and it's an extra point. Mm-hmm. At just to get to a 7.9%.
And if you're in a certain HOA or condo unit, you can't even Airbnb it.
Exactly. Or, dude.
At minimum, 30 days.
Or a county.
Not even that.
Summit County doesn't allow new Airbnbs. You have to have a license.
So another fun fact. I'm so proud of myself. I'm the stats guy today.
Wow. Here, do you want mine open?
Yeah, I know, right? So another fun fact is at this point in time, Airbnb now accounts for close to 20% of the entire vacation home rental sphere, or like hotels, whatever it is, stuff like that. 20%. Okay. So in that 20% of the entirety, there are, I think it was 4 million or 400 million. Let me double check.
4 million ain't 400 million. Cause we have 180 million households in the US.
Yes. Yes. Sorry. I want to get this right for everybody so I don't mess it up.
It's going to be like 40.
So
we were checking out populations the other day. Population of New York, mm-hmm. you being from New York, is freaking ridiculous. Yeah. Just Manhattan has more people than the whole state.
Yes,
here.
Exactly.
Colorado only has 4 million
people. There are currently...
Yeah. I think Manhattan has like 8 million.
Yeah, yeah. Houston's over 10.
There are currently 4 million Airbnb hosts worldwide. Okay?
Yep.
And there are over...
Do any of them have these shoes, though?
Probably not, because they are limited, and we got them in time. Sorry, Shelby. I'd rub it in your face.
So there are over 100,000 cities worldwide that have Airbnb listings in them.
Yep.
Now, what we are seeing, because the Airbnb market has caused such a drastic difference in some markets around the country, is, like Jameson said, cities, counties, towns in general are putting limits on the amount of Airbnbs, how Airbnbs can be run.
Yeah, so for example, here's a great example, right?
Yeah.
Before the pandemic,
mm-hmm.
right during the pandemic, again, our government makes stupid decisions sometimes. Most of the time, they allowed people to buy investment properties for the same down payment and the same rate
mm-hmm.
as somebody buying a primary residence, right?
Yep.
So that's why you see, like, Colorado specifically, you go to Summit County, Chaffee County, Eagle, all those areas. People were buying up $400,000 townhomes as investments for Airbnb with 3% down at a 2.75% interest rate. The cash on cash return on that is 20-25%, right?
Ridiculous.
Well, now what you're going to see, and I've dealt with clients that are like, hey, I want to buy a mountain property in Morrison, for example. Okay. Well, part of Morrison's in Jeffco, and Jeffco's their Airbnb is extremely strict. You can do it. You need a minimum stay length of 14 days.
Who's
going to Airbnb in Morrison for 14 days?
You know, the Airbnb and VRBOs are great because you can house 8 people mm-hmm. for, let's say, $500 a day.
Yep.
And you only need 2-3 days. That's great, right?
Mm-hmm.
You go to a hotel, you're going to be charged $200 to $300 a room mm-hmm.
yep.
for 2 people.
But there's nuances to this, right? Because there's layers, mm-hmm. just like our bottle, actually, where you guys have to understand where it's allowed, where it's not, what the regulations are. and too many people that I've seen try and jump into it
yes.
with not enough information. And mm-hmm. that's the whole purpose of this conversation today yep. is to make sure you guys understand that there is a lot of nuanced information
yes.
and things you need to do in order to, I'm not even going to say passively, invest yes. in real estate mm-hmm. because it varies by county, by neighborhood, by HOA, by lending product, by mm-hmm. property type. All of that can
biggest
change.
Biggest things being county and HOA.
Yep. Yep.
They're not going to allow it.
Yep.
You could find ways around the financing side, but the county, they'll shut you down quick.
Mm-hmm.
HOA, they will foreclose on you if you don't pay them on time. That's all powerful HOAs yeah. are. Yep. So you really have to do your homework with yeah. all this. Yeah. And the thing is that the western part of the Denver metro area is tourist, right? Evergreen, conifer.
Yep.
And then you got the western slope, which... it's a totally different game out there, mm-hmm. but there's still a lot of
great wine.
Yeah, you yep. know, Palisade, the peaches. Mm-hmm. You know,
the peaches. Peaches
but you know, peaches, that's a place where a lot of people are investing because it's, you know, I don't want to say cheaper, but you got Grand Junction and whatnot out
yeah.
there. It's the places that are in between the Western Slope and the Denver metro mm-hmm. area that's a hot, hot tourist area all year round for us.
Yep,
and that's where you got to. That's where, if you really want to invest your money, you really have to do your math because it's not cheap. And your margins are going to be a lot smaller these days because of interest rate.
Yes, and exactly. And again, like Jameson said, like Oscar just got done saying, is ultimately what we want to do is show you that there are avenues and it is possible to do it, but it is way more nuanced than anything that you're going to see at a first glance video talking about real estate investing or doing rental properties, stuff like that.
No, so, it's like the day traders on TikTok.
Yeah.
It's like, here's my, I just made $6,000 yeah. in 30 minutes,
mm-hmm.
which, by the way, is true. I've seen it in real time. But they don't tell you that they also lost $17,000 the rest of the day.
Yes.
Right?
Exactly.
And they will literally go out and
rent. What was the initial investment?
Yeah, and they'll go out and they'll rent Lamborghinis and mm-hmm. they'll Airbnb mansions to just show off this baller lifestyle. The point is, guys, if it's easy money, if it looks like it's easy money, it's
probably not.
Cute
little Dickie.
Yeah.
Right? Just save that money.
Dude.
Yeah.
I love that.
I'm going to get that money.
Yeah. So is it possible? Absolutely. Real life is a lot more complicated, a lot more education you have to mm-hmm. have yes. behind you to make the right investment. We're here for that.
Yeah.
Is it going to be a nice conversation? Probably not. I might crush a little bit of your dreams, but I'm going to pick you back up and say, look, this is what we can do realistically. TikTok, man, screw those guys. They want views. Mm. Yes, it's possible. Yes, it's possible. Minimal money. And I hate those get rich quick real estate seminars. They,
yep.
if you want to piss me off,
we talk about all the time, right? If you want to make, if everybody could just get into real estate and make $400,000 a year, right, with mm-hmm. minimal effort,
mm-hmm. whether selling real estate or investing,
well, it doesn't matter, right? Why would everybody not be doing that?
Right,
it's that easy.
There was that meme that girl said, "Oh, my OnlyFans didn't go anywhere.
Yeah,
I'm gonna get into real estate now. I gotta sell real estate to make mm-hmm. it happen." Bitch, try to sell a house and make it work.
Exactly.
It's not that easy.
Yeah.
And again, we're just bringing it to realistic expectations.
Yeah, we don't bullshit.
We
don't bullshit.
I'm not paid and I'm not hired to tickle your fancy or tell you what you want to hear. Mm-hmm. I'm hired to get the job done effectively and to save you money in the process and educate you throughout the process so there is no surprises and the end result's either going to be up to par of standards what you wanted or better.
Yep. But again, we've given you a break on it for a couple episodes. But again, this is why it is so important to have a good real estate agent that you trust in your back pocket. And that doesn't mean, oh, hey, you're going to call them up every month, but building rapport, making a relationship, reaching out, talking. Guys, again, we give you our contact every week, and every single one of us sitting here would love to have these conversations with you because education is key. Mm-hmm. Knowledge is key. And at the end of the day, again, I've said this before, we've said this before, if an agent is charging you to get this information and to talk to you about real estate,
sucker,
that is not a good agent that you want to work with. They are in it for the money. They don't care about you at the outcome. So yeah, they're going to tell you that renting is possible, that passive income with real estate is easy and it's possible because they just want your money.
Right, but now is probably prime time for that. A lot of agents aren't selling.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you that because I'm getting inundated with, come see my class. Let me tell you how to get short sales on the docket. Let me tell you how to land some listings, how to promote. no, 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 no. You're telling me this because you're not selling any real estate, and now you're trying to teach classes so you could pay for that damn lifestyle you just made yourself.
Might as well just go on OnlyFans.
Absolutely. You know what? I'll respect an OnlyFans over a freaking real estate agent and or lender that is trying to pimp themselves out for classes. I don't know. I'm sorry. I'm just jaded with
numbers. No, it's true. Real estate website.
You can't. So this is what you're doing.
Yeah. But it's just going to be ASMR videos of land for sale. And we'll just call it OnlyLands.
You heard it here first, folks.
ASMR.
OnlyLands.
Trademark. OnlyLands. There's going to be badass drone footage of just plots of land for sale. OnlyLands.
Just with some soothing music.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Like, yep.
I'm going to call out.
Or just walking back. This property is 850 acres.
I'm going to call out my wife and kids that they can never do ASMR because their whispers sound like this.
Hey, speaking of...
It's just a harsh yell. I'm like,
have you... well, that's good. You got to practice. It takes effort. Okay.
No, it's like people can whisper.
It takes effort.
I'm just going to show you this property and I'm going to brush the grass.
You just have to.
Sorry, you had to experience that, everybody.
I'm gonna do a random tangent just because I saw this the other day and it blows my mind, right? But again, I think it's a good lesson. So there's this trend on TikTok where people
AI?
No. People act like PNCs.
Yeah, AI.
Right?
The AI, like where they're sitting there. And they're
thank you for the roses.
NPCs.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you for the roses.
And there's this chick. Right.
Yes.
And I'm not even going to say the name because I don't want to give her the intention. I just don't. I fucking don't.
It wasn't even a chick. It was a dude.
I don't. But there's a point to this.
Individual.
There's a point to this story. She is on and started acting as an NPC. So for you non-nerds out there, that's a non-playable character. So think about a video game. You walk in and you run into somebody and they like bump back even though you're not touching them.
I used to be a traveler like you until I took an arrow to the knee.
Yes, exactly. Whatever. Is that from?
It's a Skyrim reference.
All right, perfect. So Skyrim, sure. I don't know.
I don't play video games. So.
Anyway, I look at it like Halo and you're interacting with like the chief, whatever. She goes on TikTok Live and acts like an NPC. Mm-hmm. For up to 6 hours a day, okay? And it is just interacting with people, and she, like, animates herself. It's the creepiest goddamn thing I've ever
Hold on. Now, let me give you an example of it.
Right? Shit, you didn't want to promote her, but now I'm going to go on and try to look for her.
So, camera's on me now, right? So they're moving like this. Somebody gives them a rose.
Here.
That's a good rose. That's a good sandwich.
And that's the entire thing for 6 hours.
6 hours. But here's the crazy part.
This Wait for it.
Unnamed human being, okay, averages 7 to $10,000 a day.
Yes,
for those 6 hours,
because
in people
each one
sending
of those
them
things,
gifts,
each one of those things, those roses, those sandwiches,
translate to money.
Cost money,
right? So the point being is
she hot.
No.
She better be hot.
I don't think so.
She better be hot as hell.
I mean, I'm sure some people do think so. I'm not my type.
Everybody's
right?
got a niche. Everybody's got a kink.
Not my type. But anyway, even if she was, doesn't matter. The point is, even when it looks like, oh my God, this person's making $7,000 a day by being an NPC character. Yes. But think about
She's
it.
She's still sitting
she
in
is
front of
sitting
a camera.
In front of a camera acting for six hours a day.
Constantly.
That takes effort.
Effort.
Okay. Yep. Is it weird effort? Is it uncomfortable? Does it make me want to gouge my eyeballs out with a fucking spoon? Yes, but I can't knock the hustle.
Yep.
And I think it ties back to this whole passive income thing. Like people will see her lifestyle.
Gig economy.
And go, oh my God, dude, she makes like $7,000 a year. All she does is blah, blah, blah. That's fine. I challenge you to do the same thing because I've also seen dudes that look like us do it that also make money. It's just, are you going to decide to make the effort, right?
Yes.
And from a real estate investing standpoint and all that, it's the same principle. If you want to put the effort in to get into real estate investing, fix and flips, long-term rentals, whatever that is, you'll get out what you put in. And an NPC character that makes $7,000 a day, to me, is the epitome of you get out what
you
put in.
You reap what you sow.
So,
absolutely. And I mean, James, that was a beautiful...
He's like that
little
rapper
around
baby.
There. Yeah.
Hey, sometimes I go off
things.
On tangents, but I will always use MapQuest to get back home, baby.
One, kind of hate you right now because I'm going to look her up and I'm probably going to fucking buy her a donut to see if she eats it.
She'll be like this. Thank you. Great donut.
Oscar the Realtor. done. Yeah. Worth
dude,
it.
It's yeah. weird. Like she'll sit there. Arr, arr, arr. It's fucking. It's like I. Oh
it's
my
the
god.
The weirdest thing to watch.
It blows my mind.
But and two, let me finish that. And two, yes, what you put into the first time it might be a little hard, and you at least you won't lose out, but you'll learn. And you know what the process is. So now you collaborate with the professional mm-hmm, and correct. Say, this is kind of what I'm looking to do. Let's tweak that a little bit. Yes. And together,
yes.
we could get your end result. Correct. And it's going to be easier and easier the second, third, fourth absolutely. Time. But now you have some real world knowledge,
mm-hmm.
real world
you get
expectations.
Uncomfortable, right?
Yeah. No, real point. World expectations.
Yep.
And now collaboratively, so you're not tied to Colorado, let's get you though that fourplex in Oklahoma correct. That costs $100,000
yes, exactly.
that you're going to
exactly.
cash flow $800 a month now.
Right. Exactly. Yep. Exactly. And you know, guys, obviously we kind of went bullish on this. We came at you real hard, real fast. And yes, there are options,
style.
Right? There are options like duplexes where you can buy a duplex, live in one side, rent out the other. And there are complexities to that as well. But we recognize that, you know, this was a shotgun approach.
Which, by the way, in Colorado, duplexes are like $400,000 a piece. So you're talking $800,000.
Yeah.
$160,000 down. Like
you
it's,
may
it's
be still, able to get away with like $720,000 yeah. for both units, both sides.
Yes.
Then you got to do the math. Right. But, reverse engineer it, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Blah.
But again, we recognize
buy a condo,
that
one bed, one bath
there, are a, there are a multitude of ways to do it, but we wanted to base it on the idea of passive income and bring it to you.
Yep.
And what I think, honestly, this is a good time to book in and roll into our One Rock takeaways for today's episode. And I think I'll go ahead and I'll take the first one. And I want to talk.
Wow, that's different.
Yeah.
Usually
yeah.
you go last.
I do. I all do, right. but I'm taking right. it. I want to talk directly to the listeners and the viewers. I know where you're at. And the first
that's
thing,
creepy as fuck.
No,
I know where you live.
I see you.
I will first, find you, the, and I will end
you. I want to talk to you, the listeners and the viewers directly. I know where you
I
are.
I know where you're at. I know where you live. No, what I mean by that is I know where you are mentally when you start thinking about this process. And first off, if you clicked on this video, thank you for trusting us with this information. But secondly, I want to commend you for being in the mindset that you are in. Because just the effort that you took to click on this and learn means that you're willing to put in some kind of effort to learn how to take steps towards financial freedom. And regardless of how hard it is, how easy it is, you need to recognize that having that thought puts you in a higher tier and gives you the ability to do something that not a lot of people have the energy and effort to do. So for my One Rock takeaway, all I want to say is if you're thinking this way, embrace that thought, whether it's real estate or whether it's a shoe side hustle. Keep pushing and keep going that route because you are putting yourself in a position that is going to only benefit you in the future.
I like it. I'll keep it simple. No risk, no reward. Mm-hmm. The higher the risk, the higher the reward. Educate yourself before you do it. An educated risk is always going to give you better results than an uneducated risk.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Mine is going, so we always say knowledge is power,
yep.
right? A lot.
Try to stay away from that. But.
I'm going to change it. I'm going to say that knowledge is potential. And the action that you derive from having the knowledge is where the power actually comes from. So when we talk about things like passive income, investing, so on and so forth, you can read all the fucking books, listen to all the fucking podcasts, watch all the goddamn TikToks, right? But if you're not the person willing to transform yourself into an NPC mm-hmm. in front of hundreds of thousands of strangers on the internet, you're never going to see the results, mm-hmm. right?
It's going to take effort, yep. hard work.
Mm-hmm. So if otherwise, do it. Like gain the knowledge, but understand that whatever you learn is the potential for an action that will actually reward.
Mm-hmm. If being rich was easy, everybody would do it.
And if you want exactly. less effort, you better have a whole lot more money.
Yep.
yep, exactly.
If you have a ton of money, it's yeah. going to be easy.
And, bro, at that point, it's chicken or the egg, right?
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. hey, if you're a trust fund baby, good on you.
Yeah, if you want to double your $3 million trust, then we can make it happen. It's going to be a lot easier, yep. and it's going to be a lot faster.
Mm.
But
I mean,
if you want to start from scratch, you got to put in the work.
That same
risk.
Point, you could be a $200 million trust fund baby, but if you don't learn
yes.
and then implement what you learn,
mm-hmm.
I could have two people that have $200 million that have vastly different outcomes mm-hmm. financially mm-hmm. over the next 10 years.
Or you could have somebody that was a trust fund baby and doesn't really know how everything operates because they've outsourced
mm-hmm.
a lot of that information to people,
yep.
right? And it makes it harder on everybody involved. But I think hell of an episode, gentlemen, legitimately like that. This is a conversation that I love having. We all love having with people. But again, our job here is to inform you and bring knowledge to the consumer. So I think that we accomplished the hell out of that on today's episode.
Real estate is not passive income.
Yep. It takes work.
And even on the investor side, it's going to be case by case.
Yep.
So just know that. It's not cookie cutter.
Absolutely.
We'll make it work, though.
So let's get moving on to the bourbon review.
All right. How do we do this bourbon review? What's our...
I haven't been here in 3 weeks. Don't ask me.
We do what's called a rock rating. And our rock rating ranges on a scale of 1 to 10. And the idea behind it is the lower the number, the better the bourbon. Higher the number, the worse the bourbon. Because the more ice you put in a bourbon, the more watered down you need it, the worse the bourbon is. So that is how we do our rock rating. And this one surprised me. I'm going to start by saying that. I went first on the one rock, so I'm going to sit back and formulate
this
one.
I'll go first.
I was going to go first.
Man, Oscar's going to go first.
No, I don't want to go first. No.
Rude.
It's rude, man.
Unbelievable. This is difficult, man. I'm trying to figure... Man,
I want to know.
Let me tell you, I feel the same way. 100% the same way. You know why? Because I think this bourbon is going to get me on, depending on the mood. Mm. There's some bourbon I'll drink and it's going to be equally good no matter what. This one, it's kind of like, if I want to be kind of like in the mood for like some interesting, complex, intellectual shit. Yeah, I could see this. This is the bourbon.
See, and that's what I'm saying. Like, I enjoy that kind of conversation. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about it before, that like the bourbon and the vibe.
Yes.
My other problem is like it's 100 proof.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to figure out what to compare it to.
Yeah.
And I don't know what to compare it to. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Because usually 100 proofs have a little bit more depth and some flavoring and some.
Like, you know what this reminds me of, honestly? Like, flavor profile wise? Uh-huh. Elijah Craig. For me.
I will fucking kick you in the shin. Why? I love Elijah Craig.
So
that's
do I.
My go-to.
No, so do I.
I
will kick you in the
shin. I like it.
I think it
like, it's almost like Elijah Craig toast a barrel to me.
Oh, hell no.
To me,
I'm about to drop this mic and get off this podcast right now. Blasphemy.
I don't know, man.
You just ruined this bourbon for me.
Because, no,
I was
going to
give it like
a good
rating. I might give it like a 12.
Hear me out. Elijah Craig toasted barrel and Elijah Craig's 80 proof, right? This is 100 proof with similar taste profile. Like, it doesn't taste like 100 proof bourbon, I guess
it
is what I'm getting at.
No,
opens up.
You know what I'm saying?
It doesn't.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, yes, if this was 40 and I went against Elijah Craig, no chance. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's almost like it gives it enough edge to go, wow, I could probably drink both and be happy.
I got to go back and watch the video with the dude sticking his nose in that bottle.
Oh,
in that
dude,
glass.
He's like, straight does this. And then, first of all, he pours it in, whiskey, and just fucking chucks it.
But ever since we saw that video, I've tried to shove my nose in the glass. There's not been one where I can get a full whiff and not.
I want to know what this guy rates it.
I don't know.
I'll go while he thinks about it. And I'm a little hurt about the Elijah Craig because that's my jam.
You know what?
Just because it's...
Because of that, that's going to be one of the blind challenges.
Yes. Okay.
Is this Elijah Craig?
Because I drink Elijah Craig regularly, it's what I've always had at home. It's what I drink neat. It's what I drink with my old fashions. It's what I drink. I know that bourbon well. This, I didn't know 8 proof would make the difference, because Elijah Craig is about 92 proof across the board.
Yes, it's 40%.
Yeah, still.
It's 40%.
This is 100 proof.
80 proof.
No. A lot
pull
of
that bottle out. Pull that bottle out right there.
92 proof.
Pull out one of those Elijah Craigs.
All right, let's do it.
We're doing it.
Toasted barrel. 84 proof.
Oh, so not 92.
I drink this shit a lot.
I like
so 42 proof off, okay? I know it was an 80 proof.
What? No, you were 8 proof off. You said 92.
92. Yes, 92 proof. That was 94 proof.
You just said it was it. What?
94 proof.
You just, did he not just say?
I thought 86.
86?
No, 94.
82.
Sorry. Okay, 94. Okay. 94 proof. 2 proof off. Right. Yeah. Anyway.
Do you want this guy running your numbers?
I'm actually really good with numbers. I've had a long fucking day and some bourbon. The drinkability is good. I think the vibe with this one would be more of a super chill for me.
Mm-hmm.
Super chill. I want some that I can wrap my brain around, and I'm gonna really think about the bourbon. This would be a decent bourbon. It's a good drinker, 100 proof. It's good. The flavor profiles are a little too on the herb side for me. That cucumber flavor, I can only take so much. Maybe I'll, you know, take a few pours and call it good. When, you know, if I'm on a bender, this probably wouldn't be my go-to, you know. All in all, it's a good bottle. I would rate it about a 4. I'll give it a 4.
Nice. I'm
a good 4.
Jameson still seems perplexed, so I'm gonna take it.
And I think the whole Elijah Craig comparison kind of got to me because that's my jam, man. I like Elijah Craig. I wish they were sponsoring me, but
I heard him.
You hurt my feelings. I heard him. You hurt me. You cut me.
So
deep.
Obviously, we take into account a bunch of different elements, but for me, I think that I'm going to agree with you, Oscar, on that 4 rating, specifically because they bolster and talk so much about how they are original bourbon distilling process. They don't really change very much. The sweetness in this is overwhelming for me for that distillation process. So at the proof, for the proof,
I like that.
Phenomenal, right? For the proof, it's great. But at the same time, there is a complexity. And again, I have a sweet palate. I like sweet, but based on the color, based on the process, I feel like there should be a little bit more.
You want that rich bourbon.
Yes, more of that wood earthiness on the back end rather than that sitting caramel vanilla that leaves for the sweetness.
You think the salt water has something to do with it?
That's a great point. Yeah.
I've never had Jefferson Ocean. You've had it?
I love Jefferson Ocean. I think it's overpriced, but I love it.
I've never had it because it's overpriced.
It's very different than this.
Do you taste?
Not necessarily the salt per se. It is a good bourbon. It's not sweet. I don't think Jefferson Ocean is not sweet. So it's more of a bourbon drinker's bourbon.
And it's not the water. It's just, it's cast to sea.
Correct. Yes.
Right. So
yes.
Maybe that's the difference. Okay.
Yeah. I retract the
statement.
Well, we should do Jefferson Ocean age at sea though. Cause it's good. It's got a cool story. Fuck it. I'm going to go 4.
4? Yeah. 4 is across the board. Yeah. Okay.
I'm going to go 4.
What plays into that for you?
I think they should age it 2 more years.
Yes. Again. It would bring out.
I think
more
they should age it for 4 versus 2.
More of the bourbon.
And if it aged 2 more years and they charge an extra $10,
yeah,
I'd be fine with it.
Mm-hmm. I'd buy it.
I think that anything 100 proof should have more of a bite.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And again, like, but
and richness.
Yes, and I mean, we always like to talk about how, you know, if you're a new bourbon drinker, I think yet again, for somebody who's new to bourbon, if they were to bring this to two people who drink bourbon regularly, as an offering and say, hey, this is what I'm contributing, I think that they'd be received well.
I give them a 2 on the marketing.
Yes.
Although,
oh, yeah. Yes. Oh, yeah.
Although, had I not gone to the website, and Ironclad, I'm looking at you. Had I not gone to the website, I would never peel that label.
True.
So there should be something that hints to pulling that label.
So if you brought this to my house, cool. I'm excited.
Yes.
You drink bourbon.
Mm-hmm.
You brought it to my house, cool. I'm excited. It's different. I drink bourbon. Someone I don't know or someone that's not a bourbon drinker brings this to my house, I'm like, what the fuck are you bringing me?
Mm-hmm.
100 proof? Okay. I'm a little excited.
Yep.
So it's one of those bottles. It's not well known. I mean, you bring, I don't know, random dude that doesn't drink bourbon, drinks craft beers, brings some, some E.H. Taylor. Hell yeah. Dude knows this shit.
Mm-hmm.
This is one of those bottles, not well known.
Yep.
You know, you picked it. I was like, what the hell is Ironclad?
You'd give him some credit, right?
Yeah, but it's 100 proof. I was like, oh, I told you at the store. I was like, 100 proof. Oh, cool.
Yeah.
You know, cool story. So it's that bourbon.
Yeah.
It's good. Mm-hmm. A good four.
I think it's a solid 4.
Yeah.
A good four.
I think solid you can age it 2 more years, and then on the marketing side, give us some hint that you need to peel it off, because I think it is from a marketing standpoint.
What is it aged in?
Oak barrels, white oak barrels.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. And I mean, to that point. Like
and it
like
could be the brackish water that gives it some of the sweetness, too.
Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah. Well, and I think that's what you're saying with the salt. And pulls a little bit more
salt
of it out.
You know, it elevates flavors. Right?
Yeah.
So
maybe.
Who knows?
Absolutely.
Who knows?
But I mean.
But God damn it, this is why we do that.
Yes. This is why
because if you sit there and you go to your local liquor store and you see Ironclad, what the fuck is that?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, shit. Charlie Jameson and Oscar had that last week. Let me go ahead and listen to their bourbon rating before I drop $54 on something.
Yes.
You're welcome.
Absolutely.
It's good.
We're here.
It's interesting.
We are men of the people.
Are you not entertained? Wrong. Different movie. But you know what I'm saying.
Right? His favorite movie.
And guys. Remember, we're here for you weekly. We do this every week. We, like I said earlier, we drop the episodes,
the vocals,
Friday. And we do the video between you know Monday.
We
harmonize.
One of my favorite, did you guys ever watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine?
Yeah.
I did not.
With Andy Samberg?
Not enough
to know. Okay, well, either way.
My eye doctor looked just like that dude.
Yeah. One of my favorite, and we should somehow put this in the episode because it's fucking classic.
Okay.
Is Andy Samberg is running a lineup. And for whatever reason,
I've seen that clip.
And they're singing the Backstreet Boys. It's like, all right, number one, tell me why. All right, number two,
bring it on home.
It's like, number four, he killed my brother. Oh my God, I totally forgot about that. That's what this reminds me of when you say vocals. Like, we're just in here singing Backstreet Boys.
Damn right we are.
Hey.
And we're bringing it here
Tell
for
me
you.
Why.
But, guys, you can catch us on Living in Colorado or at Living in Colorado, the Mile High Perspective on YouTube. You can get in touch with us. Email us at resotr@themilehighperspective.com or
phone number 303-578-0263.
And guys, thank you so much for following us.
Where are you on social media,
bro?
We just talked about the TikTokers.
The phone rang a few more times and then it went to voicemail or one of these two picked up, that was my bad. I didn't have the app.
The voice app?
Yeah. I was like, why? And I had a bunch of messages on the email. Yeah. I was like, oh, shit, I'm fucking up. And I did the research, like, oh.
That's why.
But,
so sorry,
but you're trying to buy a house either way. A lot of spam, but anyway.
You can catch me on TikTok and Instagram at @thatliftingagent.
Is it the same for both now?
Yeah, it is. I switched it.
Switched it. Nice.
I committed to that instead of the...
That lifting agents.
Yep.
All right, cool.
That lifting agent?
That lifting agent.
That lifting agent.
I like it.
Not that.
You guys can find me, the Colorado Real Estate Guy, basically everywhere.
Yep.
Oscar the Realtor.
As you can see right here on his awesome cup.
Dude, I've got shirts and I've kind of went over...
Where's the glass? You were supposed to bring the glass.
I forgot it.
Come on.
I used it. I was drinking... what was the one that we had? Johnny Drum?
Yeah.
I killed that one.
Hell yeah. Nice.
That was a good one.
Good show. We're going to have to get that Dexter again so you can try it.
I gave a bottle to my mom yesterday.
Nice. And the Uncle Nearest were two,
there were
two dark horses. They were great.
That's how that Dexter was last
Dude,
week.
Dude, the Dexter was, I looked at it, and again, back to marketing, they paid to put these yellow tabs that said like voted top 100 spirits in the world or whatever. And I was like, well, I can't not get this. Plus, it was like it's an old school bottle that you would see in like an old Western. We popped it. First taste, neck pour. We were like, oh, shit.
Oh, wow. Mm. We're in for it.
Check
out last week's episode to see a great bourbon. But
now I have to go drink some.
Thank you guys so much for joining us again. That completes our episode for this week. We're happy to have you. Come back next week. Take a look at the channel. Tell us where to go for community spotlights and new builds. We got you guys on all of it. Catch you guys later.
See ya.
Cheers.